So far, we have seen the constraint elimination method to reduce the dimensionality of the optimization problem. But there's also a different technique that goes the other way around, that is increasing the dimensionality of the optimization problem. And how does it do that? Let's say we have a very simple optimization problem. We want to minimize x1 squared plus 3x2 squared. And the trivial solution for that would be just 0 and 0. But here we are adding an equality constraint. We have x1 plus 2x2 minus 1 equals 0. Meaning we have an affine equality constraint, and the solutions, they all have to lie on this line. And it is already indicated here. So the optimum solution x0, it lies exactly on this line, it has to, and this is the point that is the lowest point that you can find on the ISO lines. So looking at the optimization problem from the top, the lowest point that lies on this plane or from my equality constraint. And now we get to Lagrange multipliers. So what we do is we construct a so-called Lagrangian. And the Lagrangian is an extended optimization problem. So our original optimization problem here, it is f of x. And my Lagrangian, it adds another variable. So my Lagrangian here is adding the lambda variable. And what I have now is my original optimization problem plus lambda times, and this is here what comes out of the equality constraint. So I take the equality constraint equals 0 and I plug that in here. And I have lambda times the equality constraint. I'm adding that. And now I want to solve my optimization problem. And the optimum solution lies at the point where the gradient of the Lagrangian is 0. So you remember back, the Newton method, what the Newton method does, it finds the point where the gradient of the function is 0. And in an unconstrained problem, the only point where the gradient is zero is in the minimizer. And here we do something that is similar to that. So we look for a point where the gradient of the Lagrangian is zero, but not only the Lagrangian with respect to x, but also the Lagrangian with respect to lambda. Or we could also imagine that a little bit differently. We could also say that now we have an extended vector. Let's call it z. So the extended vector here is it contains my x and it also contains my lambda. And now I'm taking the derivative with respect to z, so both x and lambda, of my Lagrangian, and I want that to be 0. Okay. And before I explain what is going on here, let's look at how to solve this small example that we have at hand. So first, we derive our Lagrangian by x, and we get out this equation here, and we want it to be equal to 0. And taking this equality here, from this I can construct that 2x1 should be minus lambda, and that 3x2 should be minus lambda. So this is an immediate result here from this equality constraint from the derivative to x. Okay, and now I derive my Lagrangian by lambda, and I get out x1 plus 2x2 minus 1 equals 0. And this is really interesting here, because here what we effectively get out is my equality constraint. So if I look at this line up here, let's make it blue. If I look at this line up here and this guy down here, this is exactly the same. So by the way, I have constructed this Lagrangian. If I take the derivative by lambda, I get back exactly my equality constraint, and I say I want them to be equal to 0. by saying here the derivative with respect to lambda should be zero. Okay, and now I can plug in the original results. So now I can plug in here, for example, I can derive this guy here by 2, then I have x1 equals 3 halves times x2, and I can plug that into this lower equation and then just analytically solve that. And the analytical solution is x1 equals 3 sevenths and x2 equals 2 sevenths. Yeah. Okay, and this is exactly the point x star that we have seen up here. And now I want to give you a little bit of a more a visual explanation why that works. So we have for on these isolines, if we take some point x here on the isolines, we have the gradient pointing towards the optimum. Yeah? So here we have grad f pointing in that direction. And if I'm up here, then I have grad x, grad f pointing in that direction. And if I'm here, I have grad f pointing in that direction. And now, let's remove those to have a little bit more space. Now let's select a point that obeys the equality constraint. So here we are on this point here, and we have the gradient pointing in that direction, roughly. And if I'm here, I have the gradient pointing in that direction, roughly. Okay, and now if I look at the first gradient, so at the gradient up here, then I would prefer to move them a little bit towards that direction. Because by moving my solution in that direction, I am improving the result. So by moving in that direction, I find a solution where the objective function is smaller, and I'm still obeying the equality constraint. So by moving in that direction, I'm still on the constraints, and I'm reducing my objective function. And if I look at the gradient on this side over here, I would like to move in that direction, and I would obey still my equality constraint and get a better solution on the objective function. Okay, and now let's again make a little bit more space here. So the question is, when have I reached a point where I can no longer improve? And for that, let's have a look at the normal of my equality constraint. So here my equality constraint, it has a normal direction, and the normal direction is this direction here. So it's the direction that is orthogonal to the plane defined by the equality constraint. And here, the direction of the normal is 1, 2. So the direction is 1, 2. Meaning, if I go one step in the direction x1, I have to go two steps in the direction x2. Okay, and now I'm using the red color. And you find the red color also over here. So what you find here, if I derive the Lagrangian by x, here at the end, I will have my original gradient plus lambda, and down here, my original gradient times 2 lambda. And the lambda is, for us, it's a scaling factor. So depending on how I choose lambda, I get here something that is either very large or something that is rather small, or that all could also point into the other direction. But it always, I have this red part of my term down here. This always points into the normal direction of the equality constraint. And now comes the funny part. There is one point where the normal direction of my equality constraint goes into the direction of the gradient. So here, whoops, if I am in, let's say, if I am in this location, if I am in this location, then the normal direction and my gradient, they point into different directions. But there is one place where they are pointing into the same direction, and that is exactly at the optimizer. So here at the optimizer, my normal goes in that direction, and my gradient goes in that direction. It must not point directly towards the optimum, because well, that's just how gradients go. But in this place, I can scale my lambda. So here now, I'm scaling my lambda. I'm choosing lambda in such a way that the gradient and the normal direction times lambda exactly cancel out. Yeah. And so here I have the gradient, the green part, and lambda times the normal, and they shall exactly cancel out and give me zero. And this point here is the only point where this happens. So if I'm constrained to stay on the line of the equality constraint, or on the plane of the equality constraint, then this is the only place where this happens. And this means that I cannot move in that direction and get an improvement, and I cannot get in that direction to get an improvement. I have to stay here, and this is the best point that is available to me. And so this is a really clever way to increase the dimensionality of my optimization problem, to get to something where I can again employ the Newton method, to get to a point where the gradient is zero, but now the gradient has to be zero on the extended optimization problem, and at that point my equality constraint will hold, and I will be at the point, at the lowest possible point on the intersection of hyperplanes where my equality constraints hold. Okay, so this was quite a dense slide, but we will see a numerical example of that also in quite a bit. So the origins of the Lagrange multipliers were obviously Joseph-Louis Lagrange. He is not French, he is originally Italian from Turin. He worked also in Germany and in France. He died in France, and already before the French Revolution, he revolutionized not only mathematics but also astronomy. And there is a nice quote about his work. I will read that out. So the value of his book, Mécanique Analytique, which was published in 1788, where he is introducing the Lagrange multipliers. The value of this book consists in the exposition of a general method by which every mechanical question may be stated in a single algebraic equation. The entire history of any mechanical system, as for example the solar system, may thus be condensed into a single sentence. So Lagrange really cracked a really hard problem, and with his Lagrange multipliers, he was interested in the movement of the stars, and similar to how we condense all the equality constraints into one single equation, he could do that for mechanical systems and also the solar system, and express everything about the solar system in a single equation with his Lagrange multipliers. And people were really smart at the time, not only today, and this is a result that has big impact even today, especially on physics. So people are using it in economics, in engineering, in computer science, but especially in physics. So this was invented 150 years before numerical computers appeared, and people have used it as an analytical tool, and not as a something in conjunction with numerical methods. So in his original problem statement, or statement of the Lagrange multipliers, this was in the setting of variational analysis, where the result of the optimization problem is not a finite dimensional vector, but where the result of the optimization problem is a function, a continuous function. And that is even harder and even more amazing. We will see a small glimpse of that in lecture 7 on vector spaces. And in physics, they have relied on these Lagrange multipliers in many, many, many cases. As a way to derive analytical solutions. And now, since the last 50 or 60 years, with the advent of numerical computers or digital computers, Lagrange multipliers were also immensely useful and important in numerical optimization. Okay, but now let's generalize the example that we have just seen to higher dimensions. So imagine that we don't have only one equality constraint, but several equality constraints. Again, here we have our matrix A and B such that AX equals B. And now we can still work with the Lagrangians, but now our vector lambda here, it has higher dimensionality. We have then an m-dimensional Lagrange multiplier if we have m equality constraints. And now when we want to use Newton's method to solve the resulting optimization problem, we need the gradient and we need the Hessian, but luckily there are shortcuts, and we can find them pretty fast if we know the original gradient as well as A. So this is the formula to compute the gradient of the Lagrangian with respect to x and lambda. And this is the definition, or the, yeah, this is the Hessian of the Lagrangian with respect to x and lambda. So we are increasing the dimensionality of our optimization problem, and hence also our Hessian has increased dimensionality. Okay, the problem now is an n plus m dimensional unconstrained problem, which is nice for us. The problem we have is this is no longer convex. And why is this no longer convex? The problem here is that we are optimizing, or for the when we find the point where the gradient is zero, we want to do that over the Lagrangian for x and lambda. And here in the middle of our Lagrangian, something depending on x and lambda are multiplied by each other. And the resulting Lagrangian is no longer a convex optimization problem. It is still convex in x, and it is linear in lambda, but it is not convex in x and lambda combined. However, Newton's method still applies, because Newton's method wants to find stationary points, meaning points where the gradient is zero. If we don't have numerical problems or divergence from Newton's method, if it converges, it converges to the correct location, which is then a saddle point. So the Lagrangian has a single saddle point, and this is the place where the gradient with respect to x and lambda is zero, and this is the place where our optimum solution lies. But we can no longer just use gradient descent, and we can no longer just use line search, because they would try to minimize the problem where we are not looking for the minimum any longer, but only for a stationary point where the gradient is zero. Okay, and now let's solve this numerically, and let's solve the small problem that we saw in this section numerically. So here we have f of x, which is x1 squared plus, oh, this should be times 3, plus 3x2 squared. Then here we have our first derivative, which is then 2x1 plus here, this should be 6x2. And here we should then have 2 and 6 for the Hessian function. And our equality constraints are x1 plus 2x2 equals 1. Or here we have x1 plus 2x2 minus 1 equals 0. And we can just put the minus 1 on the other side. And then have for our b, we then have the entry 1. And we want this in matrix form. So we have a matrix with only one row and a vector b with only one element. Okay. And now, here again, we have some helper variables for our dimensions. So we have a two-dimensional original problem. And to that, we're adding one dimension because we have one equality constraint. Okay. Now we construct the Lagrangian. So the Lagrangian is depending on x, on z. So z is our augmented vector, and we are deconstructing our z into an element z and an element lambda. So we just take the first couple elements from z for our x and the last couple elements from z for our lambda. And then you find exactly the definition of the Lagrangian. So here we have f of x plus lambda transposed times, and these are the inequality, the equality constraints. Okay. And now we construct also the derivative and the Hessian of the Lagrangian. And here we just follow the definition you saw on the previous slide. So what is important here, we have a new function called vcat. So vcat is a vertical concatenation. So first here we have the gradient with respect to x. And then we are adding here A transposed plus A transposed times lambda. So this is the this is the first element. Here we have our gradient of our Lagrangian at x, and this is the gradient of f of x plus A transposed lambda. And so this is here a vector. And at the bottom here we have ax minus b. So here we have two vectors and we are concatenating them vertically with this vcat command. And for the Hessian, it also directly follows the formula that was on the previous slide, only that here we have a vertical concatenation and horizontal concatenation to construct the final matrix. And here we have to fill up the remaining space with a zero matrix of the n lambda times n lambda dimension. Okay, what have we done? We constructed our original optimization problem. We constructed the Lagrangian as well as the first and second derivative of the Lagrangian. Now we can just plug that into our Newton method and get our result. And here the results are exactly 2/7 and 3/7, so the numerical solution to what had been solved analytically before that. Okay, so now we are at the end of today's lecture. So what have we learned? We learned some more definitions from linear algebra. You should already know from your bachelor studies. So the rank and the null space, also determinants of a matrix, why that is important. And we used these definitions for the null space for constructing equality constraint problems. So we saw what equality constraints are with the example of the optimal transport problem. And then we learned about constraint elimination as the first technique for solving equality constraint problems by reducing the dimensionality of the problem by using the null space of the equality constraint matrix. And as a second solution method, we saw the Lagrange multipliers that are increasing the dimensionality of the optimization problem. The big advantage of the Lagrange multipliers was that we didn't have to modify our inequality constraints. We could reuse our original inequality constraints, but we're adding additional dimensions to the optimization problem. And in the following lecture, we will finally see how we can combine Lagrange multipliers with the interior point method, in a way that scales up to interesting problems, and then we will also look at a couple of interesting problems from mechanical design, optimal control, and stock investments. And then we will have a pretty much complete picture. Then we can solve convex optimization problems with inequality constraints and equality constraints. Then the picture is complete, and from then on we will be mostly focusing on speed improvements. So what are the tricks and the mathematical thinking behind more performant algorithms that then enable more and more interesting classes of the optimization problems that we could solve in principle already, but then we can also solve in practice by having fast algorithms for them. So this was it for today. Have a good week, and see you next time. Bye.